Hi dear Africa Business Jumpstarters, this is Dr. Harnett, your Africa Business Trainer online and offline, and today I'm greeting you from Casablanca, Morocco. I hope you're very well wherever in the world you are, and we have been here for an entire week with our group on a success retreat that I was leading. It's my first retreat ever, and it's been absolutely amazing. Now, actually what I want to share with you today has a little bit less to do with business, but I'm sure I will somehow manage to tie it in. However, I felt so strongly about it that I really wanted to let you know. Is it too windy? So I've been often asked, why are you not talking more about business in Northern Africa? In fact, some of you asked me the same question in regards to Southern Africa, and one of the main reasons is that I haven't actually traveled into that region. Nevertheless, I do talk about Southern Africa quite a lot in my seminars, you know, or with my group, my members, my academy, but I haven't really touched Northern Africa. And I think this is because very often we kind of see it a bit separately from the rest of Africa. So if we talk about African empowerment and business in Africa, a lot of us, including me, I have to confess, we are often thinking sub-Saharan Africa. And in fact, when we think Africa, you know, we think black and southern, and we don't really include Northern Africa. We often refer to it more as maybe Arab or Arab influenced, and that's where I want to come in today. Because when we traveled through Morocco this week, I learned a lot about the native people of this land, which are the Amazigh people. Now, you may have heard about the Berber groups, the Berber tribes, and there are many of them in Northern Africa, and they're going all the way up to Western Africa, down rather, to West Africa in the region of Mali where you have the Tuareg. But not many know about the Amazigh people. Now, we had so many insights in this regard because first of all, we had a driver who is Amazigh, and he told us, and I don't know if that figure is correct, but he told us about 65% of the population of Morocco is actually Amazigh people. Now, what I want to share with you is the incredible similarities that I found between the Amazigh people and my own people of you know, Eritrea, and then of course we share a very similar culture also with Ethiopia. And there were so many similarities in the cultural aspects I came across here, including even the script. And I said, this is amazing. The similarities are so big and so, you know, so visible that there must be a really, really close connection between the two. And what I want to do, first of all, is I want to show you the similarities because I think they will amaze you too. I hope they do. So what I want to start with is the script. And I forgot to say that the script and the language of the Amazigh people has actually become again an official script and language here in Morocco. So the king recently decided that it should be an official language, and he actually you know, answered the plea of many people in this regard. And so we see a reviving of the native language and script, and I think that's a very beautiful thing. So I want to show you the Amazigh script. So I'm putting it into the screen here. And as you can see, it's a very distinct script. It's made up of symbols. And these symbols are so, so similar. Symbols, of course, they're using it as letters, but they used to be symbols, symbols of nature. And these letters are very similar to our G script, which we use in Eritrea and Ethiopia. And I'm showing you now the G script. So here we go. And can you see how amazingly similar they are? It's incredible. And you don't have any script like this anywhere else in Africa. And I think this is one of the biggest proof that there must have been a very close connection and, you know, a migration of the people and that they are actually very, very closely connected. Then I came across, the cultural weaves of women. So I know we have them across Africa, but these ones have been again so similar to the ones we have in Eritrea and Ethiopia. So I'm going to show you the picture that I took in the market of Marrakesh, Morocco. So here we go. And as you can see, we're not just using, or the women here are not just using the natural product, but they're then using a colored thread, a soft thread above that. And that's exactly what we do in Eritrea and Ethiopia as well. The same way, the women there use a soft colored thread to make the weaving interesting. And lastly, I'm sure that most of you, even if you're not from Eritrea and Ethiopia, you are familiar with our local bread, our staple food, which we call injera, or aita also in Eritrea. And that local bread, again, I found it here in the market of Marrakesh. A woman was selling it on the streets. And I'm showing you a picture of it now. I took that picture in the villa in Morocco. I bought some, and you can see that now. All right. And it looks exactly like our bread. It's just much, much smaller. Again, the similarities are just striking. And by the way, when I was here 22 years ago, did I mention that? Yes, I was here 22 years ago. I traveled through the entire country with my university, and we were here for a month in the whole country of Morocco. So I actually know it quite well, and it was wonderful to be back. But I remember that when I was young and we went through the markets, and there were music shops that were playing tapes and so on. And I was constantly like, oh my God, they're playing our music, because the music was so similar too. And I remember that very well. I picked up on that when I was very young, feeling someone is playing our music. And let me show, this is the music of the Amazigh or the Berber. And this is the music that we have in Eritrea. And I hope you can hear the similarities. Absolutely beautiful. But the point that I really want to make is, these are the native people of Northern Africa. These are the native people, the Amazigh and other Berber tribes of the continent of Africa. They are part of this continent. And it is so important that we actually connect with our roots and our identity, and that we don't see like division, or we're thinking, oh, because someone is not as black, they don't really belong to this continent. They came from outside. It takes a whole different mindset, a collective mindset shift for us to connect with the African identity again. That's what empowerment means to me, real empowerment of the African continent. And we see it all across Africa happening. Luckily, Swaziland recently decided to get rid of its colonial name and adopt again its native African name. And then we have Rwanda, that accepted or made Swahili the official language of Rwanda. And I have seen debates where, they are discussing if Swahili should become one of the official languages of Africa. And I think this is a process that Africa should go through again. It's not about exclusion. It's about finding empowerment within the continent of Africa. And on this note, dear Africa Business Jumpstarters, I just wanted to put out this message as a message of peace, a message of hope for Africa. And yeah, let's continue building our African businesses so we can build Africa into a powerhouse that it was meant to be and where our people can live in peace and dignity. It's goodbye from me from Morocco. Bye bye. Oh, and by the way, if you want to start your own African business in order to help the economic development of Africa, click on the link below my website africajumpstart.com and see how you can get started in your own terms.